knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
In the previous tutorial, we examined two methods of documenting a crime scene, those being note-taking and sketching. Let's now check out two more. The third method of CS documentation is photography. This is used to provide a pictorial legal record of the CS and the evidence. We must remember here that however capable the investigator might be at illustrating and describing the CS through sketches and notes, it fails to replicate the real-world impact of photographs. Observing photographs of the initial conditions at the CS and the evidence, in conjunction with the sketches, can provide excellent visualization of the CS. Often, judgments get influenced by CS photographs. They can create an impact in the courtroom by providing evidence prima facie. Sometimes, graphic photographs can even lead to an emotional influence on the jury. Photographs are often easier to grasp and understand than the notes and sketches. They serve as a permanent record to look at the CS and the evidence in detail. The photographs captured are of examination quality, and intricate details can be easily recorded, which is not possible using any other technique. A photograph taken of a piece of evidence, such as a fingerprint, a bullet, or a bloodstain, can easily be used for comparison. However, like all techniques, photography is a complementary technique and never used as a standalone method. This is because photographs may deliver a false sense of perspective. They do not record the measurements and other dimensions at the CS as accurately as a sketch. Nevertheless, there is a new technique called photogrammetry, which can be used in accurately mapping the scene by utilizing a string of photographs, but it is still under development and currently not extensively used in CSI. Photography of the CS is always done in a systematic and organized manner. It is started as soon as the investigators arrive at the CS. General photography is done first, which includes overall photos of the CS and its outside environment, followed by specific photography, which depicts the CS, the evidence, and their spatial relationship in a close-up view. Recall the TV show Friends. There is always a wide-angle shot of the beautiful New York skyline and the apartment before transitioning to the interiors. This is known as establishing a scene. Coming back to CSI, many times close-up photographs of the evidence are taken out of context. The overall wide-angle photographs of the outside of the CS and of the actual CS help in establishing the scene first, before moving on to the actual evidence. Photographs taken outside of the CS are essential to capture landmarks such as surrounding buildings, streetlights, street names and numbers, mailboxes, and fixed objects like statues and fountains. These help in identifying the location of the CS. In many cases, the perpetrator visits the CS after committing the crime to observe the investigation. For this reason, photographs of the spectators outside the CS should always be taken. Sometimes they can also be used to identify witnesses reluctant to testify. Inside the CS, photographs of every room are taken, including the ones with seemingly no relation to the crime. Four corners of a room are taken as fixed points from which overall photographs are taken. These help in creating an overlapping view of the scene from all angles. If appropriate equipment is available, photographs can also be taken from the height of the ceiling. This provides a fresh perspective to the CS, as many details can go unnoticed if viewed from the ground. Next in the sequence is mid-range photography, which is used to focus on the evidence located within the overall CS. Then, close-up photographs of each piece of evidence are taken from all sides. The rule of thumb is to capture the evidence in such a way that it totally fills the camera frame. This helps in recording every detail of the evidence, such as its surface characteristics, markings, and defects. They are always taken parallel to the surface of the evidence to avoid a distorted view. A scale, or two scales perpendicular to each other, are placed beside the evidence to give an idea of its dimensions. Photographs are taken both with and without scale. As we have learned, the marking of evidence is done after a successful search. However, photographs of the evidence are taken before as well as after placing the evidence markers. The photographer adjusts their camera settings according to the light conditions, indoor-outdoor location, nature of evidence, reflection, and so forth. Sometimes a single piece of evidence is captured several times under different lighting conditions. The question is, how many photographs at the CS are enough? Well, there is no such predetermined number. The photographer takes as many photographs as they can. If there is any doubt whether to take a photo or not, it should be taken. This is the only opportunity to visualize the scene later in the easiest manner. The only requirement is that a photography log should be thoroughly maintained. This log maintains a record of details such as time and date for each photograph, roll number, exposure number, f-stop, shutter speed, approximate distance from a fixed point, type of photograph, and a brief description of the captured photograph. The fourth method of documentation is videography of the CS. This technique provides an overall view of the CS, including its exterior. Some of the advantages are similar to photography. However, the major advantage of videotaping is that it helps to establish a real-time perspective of the CS as if the viewer is present at the scene. After the preliminary survey, the investigator has an overall idea of the CS. The videographer records the CS, tracing the same path the investigator followed. Therefore, this technique is often implemented immediately after note-making, although it can be employed a second time after the evidence has been searched. It is one continuous and uninterrupted video until all the points of entry, diverging pathways, and points of exit are completely covered, along with the location of evidence. Videography begins with a close-up shot of a placard on the screen. This placard includes information related to the scene, such as the date, time, and type of crime. The process and precautions to be followed are similar to photography. First, overall shots are taken, followed by mid-range and close-up shots. The shots should be steady, and a tripod is preferred whenever possible. The video should not include any bystander or member of the investigating team. A shot can be taken from the position of the victim as well to understand how they viewed the CS when the crime occurred. Videography is seldom used in courts as evidence, but this does not mean that it is not needed. In fact, videography is the most effective technique in certain circumstances. If the investigation is to be handed to some other investigator who never visited the original CS, the video assists in providing them with the most accurate overall perspective. The same goes for a laboratory scientist analyzing evidence far from the chaos at the scene. So why not use other techniques for memory refreshing? Because photographs might be distorted, the dimensions not accurately recorded, and it is a tiresome process to get a complete and continuous point of view by stitching them together. Sketches do provide an overall perspective and accurate dimensions. However, they are complex to understand and have less visual appeal. While note-taking is like a book, visualizing the scene is completely left to your imagination. Videography, on the other hand, is the most understandable of all techniques. In summary, the most important thing to understand about these four CS documentation techniques is that all of them should complement each other. One is never enough, and each one of them has its own distinct advantage. There is no upper limit to the number of times one can carry out documentation, and each of them can be repeated at every stage of the investigation. With this, we now understand documentation of a crime scene. Once the evidence is successfully documented, the next step is to collect and preserve the evidence. Let's take a look at that next.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.